Hello, malty mummified remains. Ooh. And thank you to Giorgio for that malt mention. Thanks, Giorgio. I think Giorgio would approve, because Giorgio has told me that he likes these sherried whiskies. And we've got one here. One of the most dependable sherried whiskey producers at the moment is GlenDronach. And Speyside Distillery, they have at the moment a very mature stock of well-matured sherry cask whiskies in their warehouse, which they inherited from the previous owners. And they have been making the most of this by bottling single cask older versions on a fairly regular basis. They can be getting quite expensive, but a lot of these older GlenDronachs are seriously good sherried whiskies. However, not all of us have the budget for 30 and 35 and 40 year old whiskies. We've got to stick more to the basics. And what an excellent version. This is batch number 2, non-age statement GlenDronach cask strength single malt. As you can see, I've been really enjoying this. In fact, it was a struggle for me to save some, put it aside, for this review. I'm going to come back to the whiskey in the bottle and the volume later after I've reviewed this. Now, it is cask strength whiskey, so I'm not pouring a lot. One of the features you'll notice with a cask strength whiskey, and this particular one is 55.2% volume, is bubbles. You get little bubbles lying in the glass, right? That's not unusual, and it is an indicator, partial indicator, of the strength of the whiskey. Gentle roll round the glass. Lovely chocolatey cocoa notes. One of the features I enjoy about this whiskey is that though there's no age statement on it, it does give some pretty useful information. It's non-chill filtered. It's natural colour. Very useful, practical information, which automatically elevates the calibre and quality of the whiskey that's there. But I'm also noticing, having tasted this for quite a wee while now, that what's very pleasant is that for a non-age statement whiskey, it's got older flavours to it. I don't know if it happens to be just the small casks, the provenance of storage, although I think that is a factor, but not all non-age statement whiskies are automatically very young whiskies. There is that trend, there is that feature. It can be a little bit annoying at times, particularly in relation to the cost. But if you look around, if you do your research, you will find there's some better quality, more rewarding whiskies out there. And perhaps it is from a distillery you have not previously considered buying a bottle of. GlenDronach bought a few bottles of this. This particular one, and it's a busy nose, by the way. Real traditional Oloroso Pedro Jimenez style, sweetish, nutty, rich, prune-rich nose and taste. Lovely, lovely, lovely. Dry wood spice on the nose, medium cream sherry, so we're talking sweeter sherry here. Cocoa, mocha, maple, walnut, marzipan, so you've got that nuttiness involved, which is quite a feature, along with that slight cocoa note. Vanilla, sage and muscovado, so the vegetal aspect of this malt too. Red cherries, that kind of fruitiness. Cherry stones, lemon meringue pie and slight wood smoke. And that's it raw. A whiskey can change considerably once you add water, particularly if it started out as a cask strength whisky. And those who drink their whisky neat with and refuse to add water miss out in this dimension. So as far as I'm concerned, hell slap it into you. If you're stubborn about the way you drink your whisky, you will get stubborn results. We've always got to challenge our little habits. With water, over time, and it doesn't take long, you'll get more sweet and savoury dried fruit, strawberry jam, cranberry juice, banana, and that's just the start of it. For young malt, this is a busy malt. Taste-wise. Now, if you taste it neat, once you've cut through the nip of alcohol, and it is quite a nip, you'll get cough sweets, cola, bitter mint, sherry, raisin, prune, and vanilla. That's the main features. But once you add water, you start to get extras because you're diluting it down. You are literally changing its profile. It's part of the range of a whisky experience. Sweeter and sweet and sour cherry, raisins, more cola, hints of sour mash bourbon, licorice, cough sweets back again, but more herbal cough sweets, Swiss style cough sweets, mild menthol growing increasingly intense, coffee, leather, and nice bitter lemon rind. The finish, cola, vanilla, ice mint, and lemon oil. What a thoroughly rewarding whisky this has been. You know what? I've really enjoyed this one, and it wasn't too expensive. GlenDronach, small batch. This is batch number 2, just to quantify that. From batch number 2, it's a malt mark. Something else I want to tell you. A few folk have been asking over the last week, months, for me, asking, Ralphie, tell us a little bit more about how whisky changes in the bottle once you've opened it. Now, it's a common experience, particularly with heavy flavoured whiskies like Laphroaig, that when you first open the bottle, you tear off that little zinc alloy seal and you pop the cork for the first time. Always a lovely sound. And you may put your nose to the bottle. By way, a word of warning, when you're smelling in a group, one of the big mistakes people do is to touch the top of the bottle with your nose. Now, just a quick reminder of something we all know. Snotters come out your nose, and bogies, and not nice things that you used to eat as a child when you wanted to upset your pals. It is a little bit off-putting if someone is going to get a whisky poured after you've literally stuck your nose onto the top of the bottle. What you do is you get your thumb and literally put just the fingernail length of your thumb on top of the bottle. Now you can sniff from the bottle and your nose isn't touching the bottle. But when you smell from the bottle or from the glass, first pour, you may think to yourself, uh-oh, it's all alcohol, it's all nippy, it's kind of confusing. There's some kind of odd stony, flinty note and mineral and not much else. Quite simply, your whiskey needs to breathe. You can hurry up the experience by decanting into a decanter, by pouring into a jug for 10 minutes and pouring back into the bottle, or alternatively, you can literally just leave the bottle open for half an hour to an hour, maybe a bit longer if it's a younger whiskey, and simply, like a red wine, let it breathe. Afterwards, when you come back, you'll find the whiskey more mellow. As the bottle goes down, as you consume the contents, a change is taking place. Yeah, I know what you're saying. Of course it's taking place. We've got less whiskey. True. When you've got less whiskey in the bottle, you've got more air in the bottle, and the oxygen molecules in the air will chemically bond and interact with the alcohol, causing a process of oxidization, which is the breaking down, the chemical breaking down of long complex hydrocarbons into shorter complex hydrocarbons. I won't bore you with the science, I'll get back to the changes now. Whiskey will change. How will it change? It varies. Malts are different. They behave in different ways. Some change a bit, some change a lot. Older whiskies at cask strength, naturally presented without chill filtration and colour, added cosmetic colour, they can be quite more delicate, more sensitive to change because they've not been so heavily processed. And what you'll find is that they generally mellow. Some of the heavier notes become lighter, fruitier notes. And it can work actually very much to your advantage because oxidization in the shorter term really loosens up, opens up a whiskey, lets out not just the range of smells and tastes in the whiskey, but the complexity of the delivery to your nose and to your palate. You may find that a whiskey you've not started off enjoying much, and Pulteney is a good example of this, particularly single cask versions. By the time you get halfway down the bottle, you're really loving it. It's such a different creature, much more friendly, much more engaging with you. It's not unusual. However, you can take things too far. When a bottle gets to this stage, there's only a drop left. How long can you leave that with all that air that's underneath the cork in relation to the alcohol? Big difference. What you can find is the whiskey becomes flat. It's a big situation you find in bars where there's harsh lighting in bottles and there's only a few drams left at the bottom of the bottle. You can get the whiskey and it tastes flat because it is flat. It's over oxygenated. And it's done so in the presence of harsh light and heat, two components which accelerate the oxidization in the bottle of whiskey. How it works is complex. What I can tell you is that it's through personal experience over time that you will know how to gauge the lifespan of the whiskey in the bottle, how the degree to which it improves with oxidization, and the point, because you'll be checking it, keeping an eye on it, at which it starts to change. It can happen over months, it can happen over years. It happens more slowly in dark, cold environments. It happens more rapidly in warm, brightly lit, particularly sunlit, direct sunlight lit environments. Something to be aware of. It's all part of the malt journey, it is, and I hope that I've contributed a little bit added extra to help you on your journey to find your bearings on the rough seas, yes, of whiskey appreciation, and hopefully this will guide you more safely into the still waters of the balmy, amber malty nectar that you and I enjoy so much. Yeah. And there you have it. I'm Ralphie. Another whiskey review done and dusted. 409, I believe, if my memory serves me correctly, which it doesn't usually. But there we go. Thanks for watching. Come back again. Whiskey review 410. It'll be another affordable, available, practical single malt. I know how much you like those ones.